Hey, what's good, Blue Pit fam? My name is Alexis Kutz, and here are a couple announcements for this week. Check in. If you're new here to Blueprint Church, first off, welcome, and we're super glad that you're here. Or if you're a regular attendee, we'd love to connect with you, and to get service details, text in person to 545454. Expanded Sunday gatherings. Beginning May 9th, we will actually no longer be using the pods in our sanctuary. This way, we could have more space to invite more people. We want to especially use this opportunity for you to invite people with Mother's Day coming up. RSVPing and masks will still be mandatory, so please use this opportunity to invite someone to Blueprint Church. Volunteer opportunities. Blueprint Church has partnered with other local organizations to do a food drive. Stone Mountain will meet every Thursday at 12 p.m. to hand out food boxes. The Old Fourth Ward campus will meet every first and third Thursday of the month from 3 to 6 p.m. For more information, email info@blueprintchurch.org, and we hope to see you there. Live stream services. This Sunday will be our last pre-recorded Sunday service. However, moving forward, we will be live streaming our services on YouTube. Please find our Blueprint Church page on YouTube and subscribe to it so that you can join us on Sunday via live stream. We hope to see you there. Giving. To give online, text in person to 545454. Or to give a physical offering, go ahead and put those in the black boxes in the back of the sanctuary. That's it for announcements. Thanks for tuning in, and we hope you enjoy the rest of the service.
about this place, Lord, because your presence is heaven to us. Who is like you, Lord, in all the earth? Nobody. So flood this place, Lord. Flood our hearts, our minds, our souls. Flood us, Lord. Thank you.
When you heard the words useful, profitable, valuable, beneficial, what comes to your mind? As you think about your own life, how would you ascribe those terms to your own life? Well, to be fair, if we're going to actually know if that's an accurate description of our own life, we actually need to know, like, what's the purpose of my life? Because what the end goal is going to dictate whether or not what I'm actually doing is beneficial or useful or profitable, right? So, for instance, let's say we're playing basketball and I'm going to be on your team. And your definition, like the purpose for which you're playing basketball, is for your team to win. Well, that's going to end up dictating, like, some of your actions, and you'll know if your actions are useful or profitable or whatever. Well, I'm on your team, and unbeknownst to you, the reason I play basketball, the purpose for it is to score. I don't care how I score, I don't care where I score. It's just as long as I score, then I've accomplished my purpose. So here I am, I'm like jacking shots on our end. I go to the opponents, I'm jacking shots on their end. We get done, go back in the locker room, and people are asking just, what were you doing? And in my own musing, I'm thinking, well, what was I doing? I was being useful. I was valuable, I was profitable. And if we look at the very curious stat sheet, it will actually confirm that I was valuable, because you'll find that I was actually the leading scorer on both teams. So you see, like, what the end goal actually is going to determine if our actions are useful, profitable, or beneficial. So for us as believers, I think we could say, like, what's the end game for us? We can just be, like, summed up in one word: godliness. That takes us all the way back to Genesis 1. Like, this is our purpose. We were made to be like him. That's what godliness is. I reflect you. I'm like you. Therefore, whatever I do, it looks like you. And we see the most beautiful picture of that clearly in Jesus. He comes down. It's like, what does God look like? It looks like Jesus. So that's why we're called Christians, like little Christ. We look like him. So now, if that's our end game, this is why we've been made. This is the purpose for which we've been made. Now we have to determine, like, are our actions, are they useful? Are they profitable to that end? Well, we're going to talk about a topic today. We're not really, the overall goal of this message is not to talk about that and validate what's the end goal. We're going to assume that's the truth. We believe that. We look in our scriptures. It is to be godly, to represent him. And one day we're going to see him. We're going to be like him. And we'll be just fully godly. It won't be the struggle anymore. But today, this is more about, how do we maintain that? How do we continue to be godly? So we're not so much worried about the destination as it is just the direction. We continue to turn towards him. And so our topic, for some of you, when I mention this, you're going to feel miserable. But I hope by the end of this message to kind of lift up your being out of the dredges of your soul. Because today what we're going to talk about is spiritual disciplines. And this, I'm imagining that your countenance has dropped, your shoulders are folding. You should just feel like, oh, I don't do those very well. It just sounds kind of miserable. Well, as we're going to go through a passage today, we're going to be in 1 Timothy 4, 1 to 10. I'm also going to reference some other parts of Scripture. Really, I have one goal, I have one hope in this message, and that is that you would actually come to cherish spiritual disciplines. Because they're the means that when we kind of enter into them, God brings us into his presence and he makes us like him. If we're going to find in our scripture today, they're going to say, this is actually life. When we practice these spiritual disciplines, we get life. We're in his presence. We're made like him. So that's our overall goal, is to cherish the spiritual disciplines. And in this, I'm going to hope to just kind of clarify four things. Got 4 points. We're going to clarify what they're not, what spiritual disciplines are not, how they work, what their purpose is, and what they accomplish. So let me read for us in our text, 1 Timothy 4, verses 1 to 10. Now the Spirit explicitly says that in latter times some will depart from the faith, paying attention to deceitful spirits and the teachings of demons, through the hypocrisy of liars whose consciences are seared. They forbid marriage and demand abstinence from foods that God created to be received with gratitude by those who believe and know the truth. For everything created by God is good, and nothing is to be rejected if it is received with thanksgiving, since it is sanctified by the word of God and by prayer. If you point these things out to the brothers and sisters, you will be a good servant of Christ Jesus, nourished by the words of the faith and the good teaching that you have followed. But I have nothing to do with pointless and silly myths. Rather, train yourself in godliness, for the training of the body has limited benefit, but godliness is beneficial in every way, since it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come.
The saying is trustworthy and deserves full acceptance. For this reason, we labor and strive, because we have put our hope in the living God, who is a Savior of all people, especially of those who believe. I'm going to pray first. Holy Spirit, I'm asking you for your presence to come and guide my words. And we really would come to like cherish your, these are gifts, these are tools that you've given us that we can actually use them to make us more like you, to bring us into your presence. And so, Lord, would you guide us into this this message and bless my brothers and sisters who are listening to this. In Christ's name, amen. All right. So if we're going to get to the part where we say we cherish these spiritual disciplines, then we first need to figure out, like, what are they not? So from the get-go, we start seeing about, like, the forbidding of marriage, the mandate of abstinence from foods, because probably for some of you, when you actually heard spiritual disciplines, maybe this is your first time listening to a Christian message, or maybe you've, you know, you've heard about Christian spiritual disciplines before, but you never really dove in it, you know, dove into them. And so your idea of spiritual disciplines is much like we see in verse 3. It's like, all right, I knew you didn't want me to have any fun. You know, Christianity's lame. It's all about, you got to stop doing what you love, start doing what you hate, and just live some of like a sacrificial life, right? Woe is me. Well, this is actually what Paul right here in this passage is actually condemning. He's saying the spiritual discipline is not about just abstinence from things that actually God has created for you. In fact, he actually calls this demonic teaching. Strong language. Be very easily for us to find offense with that. I mean, I'm not sure if that kind of speech in our day and age, if that's actually, you know, acceptable. But think about this. If there's something that pretends to offer life, it actually brings you death, you need to kind of use some strong language to describe it. You know, it's sort of like, you know, you watch like a drug commercial and it's like, you know, to diminish your anxiety, take this, but here's the side effects, probably blurriness of vision, your headache hurts, you know, your heart enlarges, lungs collapse, and you go bald and have bad breath, you know. But imagine now you get like a pill and it says, this might work, this might actually take your anxiety away. But the side effect is it actually kills you. Just, it might. So if that be the case, it's like, that's a crime. We're going to say that's a bad pill. The people actually, if they're going to put that on the market, it's murder. You can get sued for that. And this is what Paul's trying to say. Like, the people actually hold this out. Because what they're trying to say here is if you abstain, just abstain from these things, then God will accept you. So that's demonic. That is not how it works. Because you're going to live this life, one kind of miserable life. And then you're going to meet God. And he's like, I'm doing good. It held out life, but it actually offers death. It doesn't do any good for you. That's demonic. It's not what we're after. Because as you see these people, these are things that can actually be accepted with gratitude. It's like, I'm forbidding marriage, and by consequent, sex within marriage, good foods, good drink, basic creature comforts. God says, if you actually receive this with thanksgiving, it's a good thing. You know, that's why I'm saying, like, I sanctified by, I pray over my meals. I just thank God for life. I thank God for be marriage or work or good food, good drink. So we're seeing what it is not. It is not a way that you're accepted by God. That is not what the spiritual disciplines are about. We're told elsewhere in Scripture that it's never by your actions that you're accepted. It's by the faithfulness of Jesus. That's how you're accepted by God. All right, so if that's our first case, we're going to learn to cherish these spiritual disciplines, because what they're going to do, they're going to bring us into God's presence. And when we're in his presence, he changes us. The first thing we need to know is, they're not the means by which we're accepted. And it's not some kind of indiscriminate, like, just don't enjoy life, abstain from everything. That's not what a spiritual discipline is about. Well, how do they work? Let's go down to verse 7. Have nothing to do with irreverent, silly myths. Just explain, there are certain things that are not worth your time. Right? There are certain things that kind of get in the way. Rather, train yourself for godliness. For while bodily training is of some value, godliness is of value in every way, as it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come. What this verse is telling us is there's many actions. It's not like there's just spiritual disciplines. There's other kind of disciplines. There's people who practice discipline in law and medicine and education and athletics, and they shape you. And those are they're of some value. But the reason that they're of limited value is because they benefit you in this life. Why are you saying, like, train yourself, shape yourself by with these godly disciplines, is because it has implications not only for this life, but the life to come. That means when we actually practice the spiritual disciplines, we're actually made into Like, godliness is what we attain. Like, we're made more like Jesus, and that affects how you practice your law, how you practice medicine, how you do education, how you do athletics, how you do in your familial life, right? Well, this is one of the things we need to really grasp about the spiritual disciplines. Because for you, believer, you may be saying, you just feel guilt. When you hear spiritual disciplines, you just feel guilt. You know, I know I ought to be telling more people about Jesus. I'm in the conversation and I just blank. I don't even think to bring it up, or maybe I just feel fear. I know I ought to be generous to the poor, but I just kind of feel stingy, or why are they begging anyway? Why don't they go someplace else? Maybe it's like, you're supposed to be patient. And you're supposed to be kind. And you're supposed to be loving. But it's like, I just don't see those traits in me. And so here, spiritual disciplines is just another way to remind you that you're a failure. If that's your perspective, then let me suggest to you that you're actually viewing spiritual disciplines from the wrong angle. That actually almost kind of goes back up to like the first few verses. If you just do these things, then you're right. But the disciplines, again, they're more like you go through a car wash and then you're made clean. It's like you put a plant inside a greenhouse and that there's something that happens that facilitates the growth. We need to see spiritual disciplines as like a door to enter, a car wash to go through, a greenhouse to step into, and then it's those means that God starts to shape you. Certainly we know, when we go down, if you went, completed this chapter out, it's going to talk about reading the Word of God, so like meditating on it. You might be practicing silence. You might be fasting, giving to the poor, prayer, certainly. It's like, I don't even have the desire to do those things. Like, I try to have 5 minutes, I don't have time to do it. Well, let me just give you a little advice as far as like how to even enter into these things. I think it's wise. First of all, if you're going to engage in any of these things, you need to have to know, like, why am I doing it? But it's also wise to go and say, Lord, I feel tired. I know recently it's like, I've been so tired. It's like, I know I want to get up and read the Word, but Lord, I need you to actually help me. It's better to just admit our weakness in this. Like, the disciplines actually facilitate, they actually can help grow our desire. They shape us into it, but also we need to understand our only discipline is just trying to help, like, have the time to do it. And sometimes the discipline is praying, God, please help me make the time to do these things. Please give me the desire to do these things. Because in other disciplines, if you've ever tried working out before and you get a little rhythm, it's easier to keep doing it. All of a sudden you take a day off, 2 days off, 7 days off, 14 days off. It's really hard to get back into the gym. You don't want to do it. It's not in your rhythm anymore. If you go back the first day, you're going to be lost of your wind. It's just a process to get back into it. So, but part of the discipline is really you just setting aside the time and even just praying, Lord, please help me. Please help me get up in the morning. When I get up, please help me not to just go and like sit on the couch and I'm just going to fall asleep while I'm reading the Word of God, or I'm prayer and I'm going to kneel, but then I just kind of get relaxed out and I just lay out and I fall asleep. Spiritual discipline is really just all, it's all about dependence. It's saying, I need you. I don't desire you. I want to desire you, though. That's what it is. It's you're going into something. He changes you, does something to you when you're actually practicing the discipline. And that's what we actually see here. This is as we train ourselves, something happens to us. He meets us in this moment. And this has a benefit because it actually makes us godly. It makes us like him. And that's what holds out a promise. Like, that's godliness holds out the promise of life now and forever. That's what we want to engage in. If you want to have life, you want to be full, specifically for you, believer, it's why we're made, is to be in his presence and to be like him. And as we do this, the disciplines help us to actually get there. I was reading a study just the other day, and it was on spiritual disciplines, and it was a world religion class done at a college, and they said, we're going to try it a little bit different angle, because they found people come in, this interfaith class, and they started getting all caught up in like, well, your religion's wrong and all this. It's like, well, actually, let's focus on just spiritual disciplines that might be practiced across different religions. And so they're like, you're going to practice these first three. It's like silence, prayer, and fasting. You're going to do it for 3 weeks, and after 3 weeks, they're going to do another set of three, and then another set of three after that. But while you're doing it, you're going to like write down your experience. And for one of them, it was prayer. And you're going to pray for 20 minutes in the morning, and you're going to pray for 20 minutes at night. You're going to do that every day for 3 weeks. And for some of the people, majority of them in there, it's like they're Christians. They're like, I thought I already prayed pretty well, but I heard 20 minutes. I'm like, what am I going to talk to God about for 20 minutes? It's like, I'd run out of things. But as the time goes on, they get towards the end of the 3 weeks. I see one student writing out, said, you know, early on, I really struggled with the 20 minutes, but I actually noticed that, you know, once I got to a point, I feel like I didn't have anything else to say. I just started to be quiet. And I just wanted to listen, see if God would actually say something to me. He said, man, it was sweet. I feel like my ear was actually drawing a little bit sharper for his voice. You see that? He stepped into the discipline and something happened to him. His whole thing, like the class kind of made him do it, right? It's like, you just set a lot, 20 minutes in the morning, 20 minutes in the evening. That's the discipline. Set aside the time. He got into it and then God met him. Another woman, she said, I found myself, my prayers are just transformed. All of a sudden, it's about only about praying about me, like which process my classes, my relationships, you know, whatever I want to do. She's like, I just started praying for other people. Lord, I want to see them be saved. I want to see them be safe. I want their finances to be helped out. And it's like, I just started to pray for other people. And notice that the discipline, she enters in the discipline, it makes her godly. Godly being like she was made like God. Don't we see that in the life of Jesus? He's praying for other people. John 17, Lord, I'm praying for my disciples that you'd hold on to them. They're not of this world, but they're in this world. Hold on to them. Man, by the discipline, she got into this discipline and God was transforming her. He was making her godly, shaping her. Another one was silence. And so this is probably the hardest for all of them. And it's gotten harder each year because you have more and more technology. It's just hard. But, you know, one student was talking about is, as I engaged in the silence, again, much like the prayer, it just sharpened my ear. I feel like I was actually able to hear from God. And one also gave me a lot of peace. Here's a focus. We can actually apply this for silence and fasting as well. Is don't go into silence. Don't go into fasting. Just blank. All of a sudden, you're going to have all these squirrel moments. And, you know, there's so many different distractions. That was one of the things with the student. They had to just go and like lock themselves in the car. He's like, I'm in a dorm. There's so much going on. You know, one student said, while I'm actually practicing my disciplines, like I was trying to be silent, but I turned my phone off, but I had to have it in my hand. I was just so used to always having it. And, you know, so we need to go in like with a focus. What am I hoping to accomplish? Maybe if you're in silence, you just have a scripture on your mind. You're just meditating on it. Like, you know, for you or God, and there's none beside you. And you're just saying that over and over. It's like, I just want to train myself to listen. And this can be so hard. Like, maybe you just designate 20 minutes a day that I'm just going to be silent. Like I did this morning with my daughter, just driving down the highway and just taking her to school and just trying to fight the urge. Don't turn on the radio. Don't call someone on the phone. Don't turn on a podcast. Just listen. And I will say on this, you would think for someone like me, this might be a little bit easier practice because I have a flip phone. So I don't really have near the distraction that maybe someone has when they have like a little mini computer, you know, they make phone calls with. But I get plenty distracted. And so you need to have something that kind of hones in your focus and just having some kind of a scripture that kind of centers your thought. And having that silence, it brings you into his presence and he meets you. Like silence just kind of slowing you down. Or fasting, you find yourself like, I don't have a hunger for God. I don't really care if anybody says it. I know I ought to. I don't really care if anybody goes to hell. I know I ought to. I know I ought to care about the poor. I just don't. If I'm going into fasting, maybe you're even just the whole time, as opposed to eating a meal, you're praying Psalm or Isaiah 58. It tells you what a true fast is, and you're hungering and thirsting for justice. Or maybe you're praying for Colossians 4, 2 to 6, and I think it's in Ephesians 6, maybe it's like 18 on down, praying for opportunities to open up that I might be able to talk to somebody about Jesus, and more than that I might know how to talk to them. Like fasting is the means when I'm filling my hunger, man, I'm hungry for a burger or something, redirecting that to, this is why I'm fasting. I don't have an appetite for you, Jesus, would you please give me an appetite for you? I don't have an appetite to see your kingdom expand. Please give me an appetite for that. I'm not a loving person. Please give me an appetite to be like you, that you would pour your love through me. As we do that, he meets us. And spiritual disciplines are all about what he does to us. We just allot the time, or we maybe tell someone, hey, I'm fasting. You're not supposed to tell people because there's your reward, but you just might say, like, please help me. Would you fast with me? So like if I have somebody, maybe it's a little bit easier to take this journey. Now let's just say it on the front end. Spiritual disciplines, they're hard. They're really difficult. But we need to look at our end game. It's sort of like that analogy with the basketball. Like, what's your end game? Is it to win? You're just jacking up shots. Right? You're going to get two different results. But if we're holding out, like, what's the purpose of you as a human being? It's to be like God. It's to be in His presence. And when you're in His presence, you're shaped. You're made like Him. You're made to be a reflector, an imitator. And that's what these disciplines can help you get there. We get in His presence. He just starts to shape us, slows us down in prayer, in silence, in serving the poor, even in evangelism, and meditating on these words. All these are just disciplines that help make us like Jesus. Can't you see all of these aspects, all these disciplines, if you will, all these things coming out in the life of Jesus? Sharing the word. He's kind. He's compassionate. But notice what He's doing. He is praying. He has a 40-day fast. No food, no water, right? He's engaging these. They're shaping Him. Which is odd because He's God, right? But it's nevertheless, he's man's perfect God and God's perfect man. So I want to hold out to us this hope that when we engage in these consistently over time, even just seeing those students, they just did something for 3 weeks and they're already starting to see, man, I'm being reshaped. I feel closer to God. That's what resoundingly the students were saying. I feel closer to God. It's like I hear His voice more clearly. It's like I have actually a hunger to be closer to Him. These are just beautiful tools. This is why we can cherish spiritual disciplines. They can actually get us there. And in verse 10, it says, for to this end we toil. Because he's after saying that, spiritual disciplines are training that leads to godliness. It holds out the promise of life right now and for the life to come. Saying this saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance. Like, it's a big deal. Believe this. For to this end we toil and strive because we have our hope set on the living God. Like, He's not going to disappoint us. And here's just a picture picture of hope. This is actually what I want for us. As we engage in these spiritual disciplines, what can it actually look like? I'm in Acts 4 right here. Verse 13. When this is the religious rulers, religious elite, they observed the boldness of Peter and John and realized that they were uneducated and untrained men. They were amazed and recognized that they had been with Jesus. What that said about you? One, don't you just want that to be the reality? It's like, I've been with Jesus. Just the joy of being in His presence. And just so you know, this is not applied to, of course, that was easy for John and Peter. They actually saw Jesus. They actually walked with Him. No. This is not the description. Because as we know, during the crucifixion, Jesus being delivered up, they didn't look anything like Him. This is preceded, just because how numbers work, Acts 1, 2, and 3. But in those chapters, what do we see? They're coming together for prayer. They're coming together to fellowship over the Word of God. Certainly some fasting in here. There's these different, they're practicing spiritual disciplines, and they're doing them together. And as they do that, the Spirit of God rests upon them. He's shaping them, molding them. The reason this always kind of stands out to me and actually holds out that hope is that though Peter was bold, it just seems like that was his character. He was like that in his ordinary life. But what about John? Like, John's kind of described as the one that loves Jesus. You know, he's kind of delicate and he's sensitive maybe. But he's bold. It's because he's been with Jesus. He's in these disciplines. He goes in there. I just want to be with God in prayer. That's the thing. The disciplines are a means to an end. We're not always going to have them. We get there. We're going to be with Jesus. We don't have to worry about fasting. We don't have to worry about prayer. We don't have to worry about reading the Word of God. Like, Jesus is the Word. We will see Him. The fruition. That's the it. On this end, it's just saying, I want to be close to you. I want to have a hunger for you. I want to be more like you. So these disciplines are just a means that when we step into them, He starts to work on us and mold us and shape us. And this is what's kind of held out to us. We could be people to describe as like, I don't know a whole lot about God. I don't know a whole lot about Jesus, but when I look at you, I think that He's got to sort of be like that. It's like you kind of smell like Him. You kind of act like Him. Don't you want to hear that? And this is not of our own doing. Our only discipline, and that can be a very dependent discipline again, is, Lord, please help me. I want to be close to you. Please help me to be quiet. Not to turn on the radio, not to look at my phone. Like I'm easily distracted. Please help me focus on the scripture. Like I want to start to read more than 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 20 minutes in your word. Give me a hunger for your word. I don't hunger for your word. Please give me a hunger for your word. Please get me up in time to be able to do it. I love eating food. I hate fasting. It makes me feel, help me. And you start off just fasting a meal. And maybe you can get to a day. Maybe you can go beyond that. I promise you it changes things. He is faithful. We can have hope that he will meet us. As we do that, we get to have this beautiful promise that we can really cherish these disciplines because the promise is he will bring us into his presence. And when he does that, he'll make us like himself. Bless you.
He is jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us so. Thank you.
Thanks for worshiping with us. For more information about Blueprint Church, visit us online at blueprintchurch.org. You can also follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at Blueprint Church. Have a great week, and we'll see you next Sunday.